love and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name.
You may be wondering, why in the world are we showing Christmas music here in May? Well, this guy's going to tell you why. This is a dear friend of mine. This is Pastor Charles Nelson. Brother Charles has been in several churches in the Central Florida area. I mean, for a long time. He's as old as dirt, but he knows everything. And he puts together some of the greatest events, and he's going to tell you about an event. And by the way, that was David Phelps, probably the leading Christian vocalist in America today, and he's going to tell you more.
Well, here's what's happening. The First Baptist Church of Mount Dora, along with Pastor Fred Boone, is going to be going to the Ultimate Smoky Mountain Christmas Celebration, which is an event that I do up in Pigeon Forge. And this is going to be November the 14th. A bus is going to be setting out here, a beautiful Prevost bus, and 50 people are going to get to go with us up to Pigeon Forge to this event. It's just the week before Thanksgiving, and you'll see people up there. We put the best of Southern Gospel together up there. We have the Hoppers, which is a great, great family of singers from North Carolina, the award-winning Triumphant Quartet, who for the past 12 years have been voted the favorite male quartet, the Martins, who have 8 Dove Awards and Grammy nominations, another Gaither favorite, and The Sound, who have the number one song in gospel music today, and Jeff Stice, known as Mr. Piano Man, 5 times Musician of the Year, Grammy and Dove nominee, and then you just saw David Phelps. We've got a concert with just the group that's going up there for this event that I'm doing with David Phelps in the evening, and we're going to have the Wilmington Celebration Choir back him up, and I know you like choir music because you got the best choir in Central Florida here at this church. Amen. By the way. Amen. And David Phelps for 15 years was with the Gaither Vocal Band, and he has numerous Dove and Grammy Awards. We also have, for humor up there, we've got Taylor Mason, who you may have seen if you've been on a Disney cruise, and he's also been on the Bill Gaither Homecoming series. And we've got Dr. Herb Revis from North Jacksonville Baptist Church will be our preacher at this event. And we're going to be in the Country Tonight Theater, going to be in the Hatfields and McCoy Dinner Theater, Dolly Parton's Stampede. If you've been there, they've got a platform that comes out of the ceiling. We'll be coming out of the ceiling singing there. And we've also we're going to be in Dollywood for a day. So this whole event will be up there, including 4 nights lodging, 7 meals, transportation, and everything we told you about, plus the amazing Fred Boone leaving this trip. He's going to be telling you stories. You're going to have videos on the bus. It's going to be a fantastic thing, but it's limited to the first 50 people who sign up for the trip, and there's a sign up out there in the lobby, and I want you to come to this. You'll be so blessed, and I just can't wait.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Fred.
Thank you, Brother Charles. God bless you. Well, there's a flyer like this out there, and it has more details attached to it. This trip is $6.95. It's transportation, hotel, meals, all the shows, everything. That's the best deal in the country, folks. And this is open to our entire church. And anybody else you want to invite, your friends, neighbors you want to share this with, but we only have 50 slots for this, and they will fill up quickly. So you can't wait till November to decide on this, okay? So anyway, pick up the information there if you want to know more about this event. Well, let me just share a few other things in the life of our church. In your bulletin you picked up, Wednesday night at 6:30, we're going to have a special call business meeting just for a little bit of business that we need to take care of. It'll be over in our family ministry center, and that won't take long, but we just want to make you aware of that meeting Wednesday night. And then tonight at 6 p.m. over in our family ministry center, we're going to have the Laugh All Night Comedy Concert. Now, we won't be here all night, but it'll be a lot of fun tonight. And again, at 6 o'clock over in the Family Ministry Center, we have our own Scott Humpston, magician extraordinaire. He has some amazing illusions that he does, and you will have a great time with him. And then a world-renowned juggler will be with us also. And so we hope that you will come. We hope that you invite your neighbors and friends. It's an outreach event. It's free, and it'll be a great time. And so that's tonight at 6 o'clock in our Family Ministry Center. Our Kid Fest is our backyard Bible club ministry we're going to be doing this summer. We're going right into the communities, but we need some help with this. And there's a sign-up sheet at the Welcome Center for this also, if you'd like to assist us in doing these backyard Bible clubs this summer, where we go directly into the neighborhoods. We're doing this in lieu of our normal vacation Bible school this year. And then our operation, our church-wide Operation Christmas Child, we're still collecting materials. We'll be throughout until October. We'll be collecting, and so for the month of May, so it'll be through next Sunday. You see the things that we need, and we're still way behind on this. So if you could bring anything during the week, we'd appreciate that. And then also now we are also supporting Life's Choices, and we have the baby bottle banks at the Welcome Center, and this is for your loose change. And they said it's change that could change the world and change lives. And so if you would like to pick up one of those and just put your loose change in that till you fill it up and then you bring it back, we would be receiving those through Father's Day. Well, we are so glad you chose to be with us today. If you're visiting with us, you're our special guest. If you look in the pew in front of you, you'll see a card like this. And we'd like to ask if you would to fill that out, share as much information as you feel comfortable sharing with us. We would love to have a record of your visiting, and we'd love to pray for you by name. So if you would do that before you leave today, you can then give that to the ushers at the door as you exit, or we even have boxes that says tithe and offering. You can drop it in that box. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our service this morning. Father, Lord, we just praise you and worship you as the mighty God that you are. Now, Lord, we just commit this service to you that the name of Christ would be lifted up. And in his precious name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Would you stand with us together as we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth? Join our ladies.
The sun Church. Welcome home, everyone. Oh, it's so good to see you here today, and what a blessing it is to be here in this baptistry. Well, many of you know that Wednesday nights have become our front door. In other words, there's many guests on Wednesday night that have been here, some for years, example A, right here, on Wednesday nights before they started coming on Sunday mornings. This is Ken Guzman, and he has been coming to First Mount Dora for well over 2 years. And him and Liz Wave, that's his honey back there in the back, and they started coming on Wednesday nights, and like probably 20%, maybe even 30% of our congregation, Ken was baptized as an infant Catholic. And then as the years rolled by, he served in the military and so many other things, was exposed to many different things. And then he married Liz, and Liz grew up Baptist. And her mom's Crystal, her dad, Doug, Ken's father-in-law, Doug, is actually a pastor and serves locally here. And I'm so thankful that before Doug had his accident, his service is usually earlier than ours, and him and Crystal had joined our church before he was in a terrible accident, so our church was able to minister to him through all of that. And so God has just done amazing things in this family. So last week, Ken had expressed a desire. He had actually come forward about a month ago. And I said, well, Ken, I want to spend some more time with you. And so last week, we spent some time together. And I asked him this question. I said, Ken, do you feel like you're over here with lost people, you're in process, or you know your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life? And he said, I think I'm in process. And I said, would you like to know that your name is written down in heaven and know that you're born again? And he said, yes. And so he prayed a beautiful prayer, and I said, it will be my joy to baptize you, my brother. So Doug is here to help me as his father-in-law. This is a special time for this family. So what a wonderful blessing. I say to everyone, this water can never wash away what's on the inside. The water up here does not save a person. Yet Jesus commands us to be baptized. He said to us to be baptized. And so we follow this in obedience to the Lord's commands. Baptism is a spiritual marker in our life. It says no turning back. It says to the church, I believe what you believe. You believe Jesus was born of a virgin. That's what I believe. You believe that Jesus never sinned. That's what I believe. You believe that Jesus was crucified on the cross. That's what I believe. You believe that Jesus was dead and buried and in the tomb. That's what I believe. You, the church, believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and that's what I believe. And you believe that if a person asks Jesus into their hearts, he forgives of all sins, and my name is written in the annals of heaven, and I too will have abundant and eternal life. And that's saying to the church, I believe that. I've done that, and I'm going to follow Jesus till he comes or I meet him in the air. What an incredible testimony baptism is to everyone who's gathered here. Liz and Ken have one son, Emmett. He's back there in the back. He's 4 years old, and he already knows that John the Baptist baptized Jesus because of Dale and Diane teaching him in preschool. So it's amazing what the little kids can learn. So, Ken, I ask everybody this question. Is it true that you've asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior and you want to follow him all the days of your life?
Yes.
All right. Then I'm going to back up. You face that wall and let Doug over there. It gives me great privilege to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, buried with him in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. You did it. Look at the people. They're standing up for you, brother. Praise the Lord. Let's pray, church. Lord Jesus, we give you honor and glory and praise for another who has said, I will follow Jesus. Thank you so much for Ken and the witness that he is to all of us today. May anyone that's here that has not followed through with believer's baptism be convicted of that today and say, yes, I will follow Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. If awesome. You're not already standing with us, why don't you join us and stand to your feet as we focus on that incredible grace of God that while we were yet sinners, he died for us on that old rugged cross. Sing this with us.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of men and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid.
Hallelujah, God be praised, he's free.
Let's pray, church. We bless you, Lord Jesus. You are welcome in this place. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his many benefits. He who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Bless the Lord, all of his works everywhere in his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. We bless you, Lord Jesus. We glorify you this day. We ask in Jesus' name that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you would be glorified in this place. That, Lord, everyone would say, having left here today, it has been good to be in the house of the Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus, bless your people. Bless all of us gathered here today and fill us with your Holy Spirit that we might in every way be the people of God that you desire us to be. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. You may be seated. Oh, I'm going to ask if our leadership team would come here. David and Patty. Where's Patty? Come on up here. And Kitty and Sandra, if y'all would all come over here. What many of you are not aware of is that this team has been absolutely incredible since the first week of January. They have literally done all of our worship planning, and they can tell you how many songs have I picked. Exactly. I mean, I am really not I'm not a resource on it. I mean, I really let people do it, and they have divided and conquered. Sandra has done our praise teams and a lot of other integral details. Kitty has been our substitute choir leader, and she has been here when Patty hasn't. Patty has been our choir director and has been leading the choir. As you noticed, she was just doing so. And David Almond has been our worship leader through most of this time, except the 3 weeks he had COVID. And during that time, Lynn Bowman and Sandra traded off, and they did it. And so we wanted to just honor them today and say thank you to them for what they have done. So if you'll let me have the roses, baby. So, David, I didn't buy you roses. So, there you go, sweet lady.
Thank you.
Here you go, Miss Kitty.
Thank you.
Here you go, Miss Patty. Thank you, Pastor. And I have another little surprise for each one of you. I've written, this is Kitty's.
Okay.
This is Sandra's. You take that, Sandra. And then, David, I decided you didn't get gold. How about that? And there's Patty's. And church, we are honoring them and giving every one of them several hundred dollars of gift cards in the back bottom of that bag, because all of them were willing to jump in and do whatever needed to be done without one penny. And it is right for us to honor and thank God for those who will step up and do what has to be done. So would you give them a warm round of applause? Thank you. I love you.
I love you too.
I love you, David. I love you, Kitty.
You too.
I love you, sweet lady. Okay, so now, here's why I'm honoring them today. So about 11 days ago or so, it was at the end of David's COVID, so he wasn't in the meeting, but Kitty and Sandra and there was a third person, Patty. There you are, Patty. You disappeared on me. Okay, so all of them met together in my office, and I simply said, is it time for an interim? And they all just went like, yes! So they just really got excited about an interim. And so I made some calls starting that day, and the Lord brought somebody to mind, and you're not going to believe what ended up happening. So I decided to just say, okay, who's the number one in the entire state that if I could choose anybody, I would go after them?
So I decided, well, it would be the worship pastor at First Orlando. So let's just go and ask him. He just retired 6 months ago, and so why not ask him? So I went to John Marks, and I said, would you consider it? And he said, no, I wouldn't, but I will do it for you. I like you. And I was like, yay! And so he said, I like you, and you've got a great choir. And I've been watching you online, and I can't wait to work with them. So for all of you who haven't been, you've been out of choir for the last 6 weeks or 8 weeks, then I want you to know you're fixing to have a marvelous opportunity. It will not last. As we're searching for a worship pastor, this will probably only be about 8 weeks, I would guess, at the most. But, why not just let you experience the best for 8 weeks? And church, you'll be a beneficiary, but the choir will be an enormous beneficiary. And he cannot wait to work with you, Patty, and others. Bruno, he's so excited. He knows Bruno. And if you don't know Bruno, you need to know that's incredible that we have a Bruno. So he will be here. His first Sunday is June 6th. So I'm just so excited about that. Well, welcome home. Welcome home, church. The Lord has continued to bless and encourage us this week. And you may have heard me say that we are the best kept secret in town. Now, a church isn't supposed to be kept secret, but somehow First Mount Dora, not many people know we're here, and we are an incredible secret when people discover us. And so I'm just thankful that all of you know where it is and where home is. Well, you've also heard me say many times that we are touching the world from Mount Dora. I would think most of you have heard me say that phrase, and we do. We take that very seriously, that we're touching the world from Mount Dora. And so on June 17th, mine and Sherry's 21st anniversary, we'll be in Nashville, Tennessee at the Southern Baptist Convention. And this week, we have had a call that's going to change our anniversary and change that day, and it's an exciting thing. This week, church, we have been invited to the Dave Ramsey headquarters to share our story live with millions of people from coast to coast, listeners around the country on what God has done, that we are debt-free and we are really touching the world from Mount Dora. So next Sunday, we will be doing a shout-out that they will play nationally on all the stations, and it's hundreds of stations across the entire country, on June 17th. And so if you've ever wanted your voice on radio, here's your opportunity. So next week, we'll be doing three little words that'll be recorded in both services. So I think we ought to practice. It's a wonderful little phrase. It's wonderful personally. It's wonderful corporately. I want you to try it out loud even in this moment. So the three little words are this: we're debt free. Okay, you ready? Here we go. You practice. We're debt free. Now mean it like it's you personally, okay? You ready? If it was you personally, how would you respond? Here you go. We're debt free. Praise God. Woohoo! That's going to be next week as we record that. And then on the 17th, we'll be coast to coast all across the nation. So what a special, special day. Well, this Wednesday night, if you have children, you're not going to want to miss. Like I said, Ken and Elizabeth started coming on Wednesday nights. That was the first time that they attended our church on Wednesday nights. This coming Wednesday night, the kids are having a closeout celebration with school, and they're going to have bounce houses and food and all kinds of stuff. If you didn't know this, on Wednesday nights, our children's ministry pre-COVID would run 125 kids. I mean, it's staggering. Now, since COVID, we have really struggled coming back, and you know it hit kids harder than actually any other group as far as them being closed down. So they were the last ministry that we brought back. So we need to pray for our children's ministry and that God blesses and we get some new families coming even this Wednesday night. Well, there's someone else I want to recognize. Hebrews actually says, Hebrews chapter 13, beginning in verse 17. I misquoted in the early service. I said it was verse 7. It's 17. Excuse me. I left off the 1. And Hebrews 13, 17 says this, "Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give an account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you." So we're to not just obey them, but we're to honor them. And this morning, I want to honor one in a special way. So come here, Josh. Come on up here. Church, I searched the world over and thought I'd found true love. But anyway, some of you would remember that. I searched the world over for a special gift for Josh and Julie. Julie, you can come up for this too. And Sherry, I want you to bring this on up. And this is going to be something I wanted them to have to remember First Mount Dora and 5 of the best years of their life forever and always. She can't really carry it. I'm sorry. It's very heavy. So I finally found it in Great Britain, and then it took several weeks to be shipped over. And then it had to go to the framers to be framed, because I want him to have something that he will always appreciate, that he can take with him to Africa and that he can bring back home one day and have with him, that always would say First Mount Dora. So go ahead, Josh and Julie, open that package. And church, you have not seen this. They don't know what this is. Turn it around. Okay, some time ago I asked Josh, what is your favorite text? And he said, John chapter 15, verse 13. "Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends." And so I wanted a first edition King James, 1611. None of those exist anymore. Not that are for sale anyway. So I found second edition. This is from 1634. 1634. And it is his passage from John chapter 15. On the internet, there was one in the entire world for sale, and this is it. And so it says at the bottom on a plaque, First Baptist Church of Mount Dora, 2016 to 2021, King James Bible, 1634. I love you, John. I love you, Julie.
Thank you so much.
Now, before we commission him, and that's what we're doing, this is a church that's just celebrating all day. If you hadn't figured that out yet. We celebrate those who serve. We celebrate being debt-free. Now we're celebrating and commissioning Josh, and we're just celebrating all day. And so I want us to pray over them. We're going to do that. But I would like for him, David or Patty, bring me a mic real quick. And I want him to be able to say a word to the church real quick. So we didn't have time for this in the first service. So I know he's already said a word when he resigned. It's number 4. And so,
we are incredibly, incredibly grateful. When we think about what love looks like, it's been displayed in action, it's been displayed in encouraging words, it's just by presence. Pastor, we love you. We love this church. I want you to know that we go out in God's power. God says all authority under heaven and earth is given to me. We go out with his plan, and it's a perfect plan. Make disciples.
That's right.
How do we do that? Going, baptizing, teaching. Church, I want you to know that we go out in God's presence, because he says, I'm with you always, even until the very end of the age. And so, church, we're planted firmly. We're going after advancing the kingdom, because it's here where the soil of the gospel, of the humbleness that we only could get from Christ, that grew and strengthened here. The fruit of so much of what we accomplish and do is because of you. Mm. And we are incredibly, incredibly thankful. So be encouraged, church.
Amen.
Everything that God is doing is a work from the fruit and the soil of what he's accomplished in the last 5 years.
Amen. Amen. I love you so much. You know that already, though. You know I do. Well, if y'all will come down here, let's push these chairs up a little bit. And our time was so limited in the first service. So here's what I would like. Sherry, baby, you come over here behind Julie. Julie, you sit right here. And Josh, you right here. And then Mark, you come on up. Daddy needs to be here. And then I'm going to ask all of our church leaders, come on, Brother Fred, and Scott, y'all come on up. All of our deacons, if y'all would come on up. And any of our other leaders, if you worked in the youth ministry and you want to come up and say a prayer over Josh, that's just fine. And so we're going to have a prayer time over him and Julie and pray for them. Come on, Brother Charlie. And so, Matt, can you leave the microphone just for a moment? You can't. You know, it'll be too dangerous. Okay. And so come on down. A lot of our deacons are actually teaching Sunday school right now. And so that's where they are. So are there others that would like to come? You feel free. And so we are just so grateful. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray over them. And where you are, here's one of the things I would ask for you to pray. Would you pray that God would protect them, protect Josh and Julie? Also, and I'm going to be very specific, would you pray that they wouldn't get malaria, them or their babies? Malaria is very common there. Everybody gets it. And it is just a rough, rough thing. So would you pray that specifically for them and pray that God would protect them and provide for them? So if you would, gentlemen, come on around them. And Brother Fred, if you'll start, and then any of y'all can jump in.
Father, Lord, we come to you today just to praise you for bringing one out of us that would go to the mission field. Lord, we see this as an extension of the ministry here. God, we just thank you so much for Josh and Julie and their great obedience to you, Lord, to answer the call and their courage to go to a place that is a very difficult place and so far away. But God, that's your call, Father, and they've heard it and they've responded. And Lord, we pray, God, for your blessing upon them, your watch care over them. God, we pray for their safety. We pray for their health. We pray for their children. God, we just put them in your hands. And Lord, we're so grateful for the work that they'll be doing. An extension of us to another place, another land. It's such a dark place that doesn't have the gospel available like it is here. And as they go and share and raise up pastors and train pastors, Lord, bless them and encourage them. And God, we just send them out in your name. Lord, thank you for the privilege to mission these missionaries.
Father, I do thank you for Josh and all his years here pouring into the youth, pouring into my children, that you would just watch over and protect me, Julie, and their children, and that the seeds that they plant in Uganda, that would just, the harvest would go on for years and years and years, Father. You would guide and direct them in their words, give them deep wisdom, interact with the people there, train up pastors, train up leaders. Father, we just give you the glory for all of these things. Continue to guide and direct Josh and his steps in ministry and Julie. Allow her to pour into the women there, to raise her children there. Father, thank you for Mark and Karen raising Josh here as a man after your own heart. Father, thank you for what you've done in blessing our church with their ministry. And you would go forth and make their path straight. In Christ's name, I pray.
Father God, you called your son Jesus to the cross. And I thank you for calling my son Josh to Africa. I pray, God, that you will bless he and Julie. That, Father, that they and Titus and Judah will just do great work for you, and that many lost people will come to Jesus. Father, thank you for this church, for the blessing of this church in our lives. Thank you for our pastor and his wife, and for how they have surrounded our family through so much. I pray for my son Justin and Sharla and their family who are in Uganda even this very moment. I pray that you would keep them safe, just as I pray now that as Josh and Julie and Titus and Judah go, that you would keep them safe. I pray, Father, for Julie's parents, Jan and Al, and for Karen and I, that you will give us peace as our children and grandchildren are so far away. But Father, I just pray that even this moment and in the many days ahead, that you will constantly bring them to our mind, that we might just lift them up in the power of prayer once again, knowing that Almighty God, even though they're so far away, that you are with them always, and that they're in the palm of your hand. Thank you, Jesus.
Father God, we're so thankful for how you blessed us when you brought Josh and Julie here. We know, Lord, that you brought them here because they were a blessing to this church. They worked with the young people, and the department grew. And we pray, Lord, that it will continue to grow. And Lord, we thank you for calling them to the field where you want them to go. You call them, and you're sending them. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to bless them while they're on the mission field. Keep them safe. Protect them as you called Paul when he went out on the mission field. Although he went through a lot of danger, we know that you were with him. You blessed him. We know that you're going to do the same for Josh and for Julie, because you've said, according to your word, that wherever we go, that you will be with us. And we know, Lord, that you will stand on your word. Bless and keep them. In Jesus' name, I pray.
now, Lord, we commission these two, our two missionaries, as we continue to touch the world from Mount Dora. Lord, may they not be the last that we send out. May that you raise up others who would be willing to go to the ends of the earth. And so we ask in Jesus' name that, Jesus, you would be glorified in them and through them, that you would go before them and prepare the way, that you would go behind them and, Lord, protect them from the flaming arrows of Satan himself as he seeks whom he may devour, that you would go beneath them, Father, so that they may never fall. Now to him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before his glorious presence with great joy. And Lord, may you go above them where they would always know where to look for their help. I look up, Lord, from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And Lord, we pray most importantly, you would go in them. Go in them, Lord, filling them with your Holy Spirit and using them in a divine and powerful way to accomplish your will on earth as it is in heaven. For greater is he who is in them than he who is in the world. And so, Lord, you bless them and use them.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen and amen.
Church, many of you may have never seen a commissioning service. It's always a powerful thing to send out those that you love. Today, if you want to give toward their mission, you'll be able to give at the end of the service, either at the doors or at the Welcome Center. If you write a check, make it just to Africa Missions. Don't put their name on it. We'll know if you put Africa Missions, just do that, and we'll write them one check from the church. And so what an incredible opportunity we have. Well, I'm continuing on with the series about the Holy Spirit. And this week I want to introduce to you an amazing concept that comes right from the Word of God. And it is because of the Spirit. You may never have thought about this before, but the concept is that of spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare. In other words, we used to sing an old hymn that was beautiful but had wrong doctrine. And we would say, "This is my Father's world." And we would sing that old hymn. There's one problem with that. This is not my Father's world. Scripture is very clear that the world belongs to Satan for such a time as this. This is the old devil's world. He's been cast out of heaven, and this is where he landed, on your doorstep. So the old devil is alive and well, and he infects us, and he infects every nation and every state and every continent, and sin is alive and well all over the world. It really is. And today I want you to see how the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is what literally holds back the hand of Satan. In fact, I will say this, without the Spirit of God, the world would be in utter chaos. Now, I want you to know that day is coming. That day is coming. When the rapture happens and the church of the living God is taken out of this world, the Holy Spirit, who dwells where? In you, is removed because the Holy Spirit dwells in people. And when everybody that knows Christ is gone, the Spirit is gone, and that's when the world will become a very ruthless place. Very, very ruthless. And we all know every day that he tarries, it's one day closer. We all know. Time is short, and the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So he's going after everyone that he can right now. So if you would, turn if you would to the little book of Galatians, the little bitty book of Galatians. General Electric Power Company, it's the general. It's right after 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians. But that's a good place. I always had trouble as a young person finding where are they talking about in the Bible. So that's where it is. Galatians is before Ephesians, Philippians, or Colossians. We're going to be in chapter 5, beginning in chapter 5 today, because right here we have the introduction of the concept of spiritual warfare between the Holy Spirit who dwells within you and your flesh, which is motivated and empowered by sin. Now, if you have never received the Spirit, if you've never been born again, if you're not saved, how are you motivated? You're motivated by the Spirit, by the flesh. When you become a Christian and you're born again, does the flesh cease to exist? No. So a Christian has two natures, not one, two. A lost person only has one nature, flesh. That's it. And so we're going to look at the conflict between the two and why all Christians struggle with this, beginning in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. Let's all stand in honor of God's word. Galatians 5, beginning in verse 16. Hear the word of the Lord. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are, and then he goes into this long list, adultery, fornication. Let me give you the difference between the two. I'll never forget when I was playing football 100 years ago, and in the locker room, the quarterback on the football team was sleeping with his girlfriend, and he said, that's not wrong because it's not adultery. And I said, it is wrong. And he said, no, it's not. I said, yeah, it is. I said, it's a sin. And he said, no, can't be. Now, this boy didn't go to church. I went to church, and I said, it starts with an F. I don't know what it is, but I'm telling you, it's a sin. I know it's in there. I didn't know how to pronounce the word fornication. So adultery is if you sleep with somebody that you're not married to, okay? Fornication is when you're not married, and you sleep with anybody else. Both are listed so that we have that down. Uncleanness, I don't need to give a description of that. That's everywhere. And it's all kinds of sexual acts. Lewdness, it falls into that category as well. Idolatry, most of you in the room would say you're not guilty of that. We will look at that closely in this little bit. Sorcery, we would also say it could be sorcery or witchcraft. We would say we are not guilty of sorcery or witchcraft, the majority of it. However, I'm going to look at what the Bible says to do about it, not whether you think you're sitting in front of a fire going hocus pocus, okay? So you need to know what the difference is, and you'll be surprised. Hatred, this is unseen. Most of the time, hatred, contentions, and jealousies are unseen. They're within a person's heart. Outburst of wrath, those are seen, and it's called driving in Orlando or down 441, and you can have those. Selfish ambition, we think of ambition as a good thing. Selfish ambition is listed here as a big problem. Dissensions, heresies, envy, And then it comes to one that we would say is a big one, murder. He's listed all these other things prior to murder. Drunkenness, revelries, and the like. When people say there's no problem with alcohol, just look right there. It's listed in all of these things and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, what does that mean? It means that they are not born again. The flesh is controlling them. Verse 22 switches to the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is, now this is what you're to have, love, joy, peace, patience or long-suffering. You understand, we use patience today more than long-suffering. Patience means to suffer long, which is long-suffering. Kindness, oh, there's far too little kindness today. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. See what we're to do to our flesh? We're to crucify it. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Envy is a deadly thing. Brethren, if a man is overtaken by any trespass, let me stop right there. Do Christians still sin? Okay, so Christians still sin. So if we're overtaken by a trespass, let me go ahead and tell you, you will be overtaken by a trespass. Okay? At some point, as believers, all believers still sin, you will be overtaken. So what are we to do? You who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For each one shall bear his own load. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he will also reap. For if he sows to his flesh, will of the flesh reap corruption. But if he sows to the Spirit, will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. May God's word not come back void. You may be seated. So we're to do good, especially to those who are in the church, especially to those who are born again. Well, let me go ahead and tell you, if you desire to have more of the qualities of the fruit of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Helper, the Comforter, that are listed right there in verses 22 and 23, then you need to know that is from the Spirit of God. In other words, let me ask you this question. Do you want to be more joyful? That's coming from the Spirit of God. Do you want to be more loving? That's coming from the Spirit of God. Do you want to be more patient? Yes. Then that's coming from the Spirit of God. And you can move through these. Do you want to be a kind person? When people think of you, do they think of kindness? Well, I can look around the room and I can think of a number of people. That's how I would identify you. You're so kind, and that's coming from the Spirit of God. Do you want to be more faithful? I hope all people would want to be more faithful, more self-controlled. That is the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, I want you to understand this very clearly, beginning in verse 16. I read to you from the New King James Version, "Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." I want everybody in the room to have a clear understanding of what this is. So I'm going to read it to you from the NIV, just so you understand. What are we talking about here? So I say to you, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Live by the Spirit, you won't gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other so that you do not do what you want. They're in conflict. In other words, there's a great battle raging in every Christian's heart between the flesh and the Spirit. The flesh and the Spirit wage against each other. Every one of us in the room, it takes but a moment for any of us to want to be selfish. It's the inclination of every human heart. How do I know that? What's the first words a baby can say? Mine and no. Mine, 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 mine. That's a selfishness, an ambition on their own part. You know, a baby can lie and steal before they can talk. You tell a baby, don't you touch that. Now, they understand you. No, no. So you walk out of the room, they've got it in their hand. You walk back in there, and you say, did you take that? They go, they've got it in their hand. They're lying and stealing. They're a baby. That's the heart of the flesh. All of us have that within us. We want to say, mine. We can be very possessive of anything and everything. Possessive of people, possessive of positions, possessive of territory. People can be so territorial. Just possessive. That's selfish. That's selfish. And so we always have to be on guard with all of these things, that we would not in any way be led by the flesh. So here we have this introduction to spiritual warfare. We don't do what we want to do. And why do we not do what we want to do? We don't do what we want to do because of the flesh, even though the Spirit is leading us and saying, this is what you need to do. So we have to learn to be Spirit-controlled. Now, here's what happens. When a person is born again, some of you, let's say you've been a Christian for a year. Others of you, 5 years. Some of you have been a Christian for 10 years. Some of you longer than 10 years. Spiritual growth is not dependent upon physical years. It's different. So one person who's saved and born again in the first year of life may grow to be 10 years old spiritually. However, another who has been saved 10 years may spiritually still be an infant and in diapers. They're less than one. And so spiritual and physical do not line up. I've seen this many times when a person devours the Word of God and they're praying and they're growing and they can grow many years very quickly. But as time goes by, the spiritual nature should become greater than the physical nature. So physical, the fleshly heart. And so our fleshly heart starts here. We're born again, and we're here. And what has to happen if we're to ever move beyond immaturity spiritually is that the Spirit grows larger while the flesh grows weaker, and finally, the Spirit always trumps the flesh. But it'll always be a battle. We have to trump it. How do I know this? I know this because of our senior adults. They have taught me so much. I have had ladies and gentlemen come to me who are in their 70s and 80s, and they have said to me, I have worked through all these emotions when I was in my 20s and 30s, but you will not believe how my daughter-in-law has treated me over the last 3 years and what has happened in my life. And they start telling me what their daughter-in-law or son-in-law or somebody has done, and they're right. It has been criminal offenses. I mean, it's outstanding. And what it's done is it's caused resentment in a mature believer's heart. This person's been a Christian for 25 years. They've dealt with these emotions before. And all of a sudden, the old devil has gotten in there and pushed the button hard and won't let go. That's why I've always said, the hardest battles you will ever fight, most likely, the most difficult conversations you will ever have, for the majority of you, will be people that you are related to. Either close or distant, they'll still be a relative. And for those of you who have no idea what I'm talking about, first of all, I know you are an only child, and so were your parents. And second of all I can say is I'm so proud for you. So proud for you. You don't have Facebook friends, and if you do, they're distant. They're not up close. So that's pretty amazing when, you know, but we need to get to the place where I am crucified with Christ. Therefore, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So now, let's go back to this thought of all these fleshly things that he begins to list right there in verses 19 and following. And he has a long list: adultery, fornication, uncleanness. He goes on and on and on. The first four all deal with sexual things in nature. I have heard statistics that say a man can lust in 0.3 of a second. That's like Olympic record speed, man. I'm telling you, that's like, you understand this. Have anybody ever watched the stopwatch on Olympics where they measure it down to the not tenth of a second, hundredth of a second? I've even seen it thousandth of a second. Okay, that's about how fast it takes a man to sin. Now, ladies, I haven't seen any studies on you, which I think is pretty funny, but I don't know why they want to pick on guys like that. But it doesn't take a man long to have a sexual thought. I mean, he doesn't have to try, folks. That's just the truth. Now, if I'm offending some of you, good. Good. And some of you are looking at me going, boy, we got a crazy pastor. I'm just telling you, that's just the nature of the beast. We're all in flesh and blood, okay? Everybody in here, you still have a heart of flesh. So we all will have evil desires. And we can't just ignore them. We need to deal with them in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we have to deal with them decisively, which is, Jesus said, crucify. Crucify. That's pretty decisive when it talks about the fleshly nature. So these desires include all of the obvious, such as sexual immorality and witchcraft. And witchcraft, I've been surprised at. I'll never forget reading this verse. If you turn to 1 Samuel 15, verse 23, the Bible defines witchcraft. Now, most of you think it's like sitting around a fire trying to cast a spell on somebody and all that. The depth of our sinful nature most of the time is unknown to us. In other words, when an individual is selfish or prideful, most of the time they don't understand how selfish or prideful they are. If a person is arrogant, they don't understand how arrogant they are. If a person is, and you can go, listen, I've talked to drunks who didn't understand how drunk they were. Every police officer has pulled over a drunk person, and they don't think they're drunk. They can still talk, kinda. They would never, ever guess that something's wrong with them. You know, most of the time, you don't know how bad your problem is. A drunk person doesn't know how bad their problem is. A selfish person doesn't know how selfish they are. A prideful person doesn't know how prideful they are. The list is, you put it in, a greedy person doesn't know how greedy they are. And here's the truth. Any of us in the room would say, we don't practice witchcraft, but look at what the Word says. 1 Samuel 15, 23 says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Who in the room has not been rebellious? Every one of us have been rebellious. Every single person is rebellious. And God says in His Word that that's like witchcraft. Oh, my goodness. You know what this means? I'm more of a sinner than I knew. That's right. You are. You're more of a sinner than you know. All of us are. And then it goes even further, and he says this, and stubbornness is as the iniquity of idolatry. You think you're not an idol worshiper, but most every person in the room has been stubborn. Some of you are named stubborn. I mean, that's just the truth. And it's like idolatry. And most every parent knows who's the most stubborn child that they have. Kim, Do you know who's your most stubborn child? Of course, she knows immediately. Joanna, you know you're your most stubborn child? You do. You have three, don't you? Yeah, and you can pick out which one's most stubborn. Danny, Pam, do you know which one's your most stubborn child? Oh, Pam is doing a big nod. What about you, Eric? You know which one's... You be careful. You got two with you. So, do y'all know which one's your most stubborn? One of the ones here. Okay, so I wouldn't have confessed that, but there you go. Most every parent knows who is their most stubborn child. But all children are stubborn at some point. And you are too. And you know what that God calls that? That's like idolatry. You know why? Stubbornness is like idolatry because it's saying to God, I can do it. Let me do it. How many of you have heard a child say, let me do it. I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. And you know what? That never gets out of our system. It never goes away. All of our life, we're saying to God and to others, I can do it. I can do it. Let me do it. I can do it. And that becomes idolatry. It becomes an idol because we're saying, I can handle things on my own. And we're not submissive to God. Your idol does not have to be concrete or wood. It doesn't have to be gold or silver. The worst idol you will ever know, you're looking at them. You look down and you'll see their feet. That's where they are, right there. We all struggle with being stubborn and rebellious. And it becomes witchcraft and idolatry. It puts in perspective for us how thoroughly fleshly our heart is. Our heart is thoroughly fleshly. It is thoroughly filled with lust of all kinds. And so it takes God's Holy Spirit to begin to conquer our own flesh. Our own flesh. The other evil desires are less obvious. Many of these are hidden. They include such sins, and it's listed right there. Selfish ambition. Selfish ambition. Do you know what? I think it's funny. It's very sad, actually. The two richest men in the world, Jeff Bezos and Bill Gates, are both going through divorces. Both of them. Selfish ambition has led them to a place of no return. You know, it's absolutely... Now, guys... If the two richest men in the world can't keep their wives happy, what hope do you have? So you could put it in that kind of perspective, you understand. I mean, David, you better be working some overtime, dude. I mean, you could look at it like that. But the truth is, those women, money wasn't their motivator. At some point, something else was missing. And selfish ambition had taken over. What about other things that it lists there? We're wrong if we don't notice hatred and jealousy. Some people say, well, I don't hate anybody. I'm not like that. And that's good. That's good. You should, as a believer, not hate anybody. But the truth is, we cannot ignore such sins or refuse to acknowledge that they exist. Because if we're going to really be filled with the Spirit and have a transformed life, then we cannot hate or be jealous or be envious. You can't just be dismissive either of people who have wronged you. There's balance there. I'm not saying that you just overlook every wrong that people have done to you and you never deal with it. That's wrong too. But I am saying, as a follower of Jesus Christ, you have to deal with all of these feelings and emotions and your anger and seek Christian counsel. Deal with another Christian brother or sister to help you process this. If you deal with all of those things, then for some, their forgiveness is instantaneous. For others, it is a process, and it'll take more time. One of the things I've noticed through the years is, in my office, we've dealt with a lot of things that our members have had to struggle with. We've had members who had relatives murdered or who've gone through rape and incest, and the list is long. One of the things I've discovered is this. When I think about scales of sin, those who've had to endure a murder, rape, or incest, I have noticed this, they have been very quick to forgive those who have wronged. I'm always amazed at that. They usually start the conversation off by letting me know that they've forgiven, which is just amazing. Then over here on the other side, I've had people who really struggle, and someone has said something bad to them and it wasn't true. Or they've said something bad about them and it wasn't true. Or they've said something bad about them and it was true. And so in my mind, which would be harder to forgive? Over there. The murder and the rape, all that would be harder. Yet what I've discovered is people who have had verbal sins committed against them many times struggle the most to forgive. It's very, very difficult for them to forgive those who've said bad things about them. But in putting it in perspective, you understand we have to realize, to put it in perspective, now I know people can be very nasty verbally, but as a Christian, you've got to get to the place where you forgive. Now, here's what I tell most people. You start out verbally, and the heart and the mind will eventually catch up. For some people, when I've led them through prayers of forgiveness, it's instantaneous, and they get up, and it's amazing. They have forgiven, and it's thorough, and they'll tell me 6 months later, it's thorough. It was done. It was finished. I would tell you that's not 50%. The greater portion, 60% or better, forgiveness is a process. And they begin verbally by stating, Lord, help me to forgive those who have done this wrong. And then it moves from help me to, Lord, I forgive, and they fill in the blank. And then eventually it gets to the place where they're, Lord, thank you. As far as I know how, I've forgiven those who have sinned against me. And it moves. It's a process. It's not a 24-hour thing. It can take time for that healing to occur. But let the Holy Spirit work in you. Don't be afraid of the Spirit of Jesus Christ and Him revealing these things to you, and the anger and upset and bitterness that you have felt for some people literally since their childhood. It is time to let that go. I've had so many people that literally they were so deeply hurt when they were children, and they have to move to that place of forgiveness where they've let it go, and they've asked God in every way to help them, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, they're able to do that. Now, when you come to Christ, you have these two natures, the old nature of the Holy and the Holy Spirit nature, the Spirit of Jesus within you, and they're in this constant war. But after you have victory in Christ Jesus over the flesh once, then you realize you can have it again and again and again, and your spirit, the Spirit of Jesus in you, will begin to diminish the fleshly nature. But don't ever think that you're so strong in Christ that you can't fall. Let me give you a perfect example out of the Bible. I've had people tell me that as a Christian, you can't be slobbery, dirty, nasty, drunk anymore. And I say, you err because you do not know the Scriptures. There was a man who, by the way, did more than all of us put together. He literally gave six generations of accrued wealth. In today's terms, he would have been a multi-multi-millionaire. Not like 5 million. I mean, way more than that. Multi-multi-millionaire. And he gave all that he had, of all the financial wealth that he had, for the kingdom of God. On top of that, he preached the message of repentance for 100 years. For 100 years he preached over and over and over again, preaching and preaching and preaching and telling everyone, you need to repent of sin because God's going to judge us. You need to repent of sin because God's going to judge us. And then he ends up getting sloppy, dirty, naked, drunk. I mean, unable to remember nada. And his name was Noah. His name was Noah. So anybody can fall down after doing the work of the Lord for many years. Don't ever think that you're above that, that it can't happen to you. It can. We all have to be on guard and realize the flesh is still there. The flesh is still there. So when you fall down, what do? You get back up. Many people think that they're so bad that God cannot forgive them, that he cannot use them anymore. I want you to know that is not true. The Lord wants to forgive you. The Lord wants to help you, but you have to repent of the sin and ask for forgiveness and move forward. So I want to show you some slides this morning real quick, and I'll wrap it up. I've got several more pages, but I know you're tired. I want you to see this. The flesh and the spirit are at war with one another. So the will of the Holy Spirit is in constant opposition to sinful desires. Constant. The two are at war. In other words, they're opposite sides of a spiritual battle. And then, go to the next slide, our wrong desires create evil, whether it's something that no one can see, like selfish ambition, or whether it's something that others will know about, like adultery. But then the fruit of the Spirit is always good. The fruit of the Spirit always wants our best and the best of others. So the next one. Our wrong desires are always destructive. And Paul listed them. Whether it's adultery and tearing up a marriage or whether it's drunkenness, the list was so long. You can go through. There's tons of things that are destructive. But the fruit of the Spirit is always productive. It will help you and help others. The fruit of the Spirit is not just given for you. Your joy is to rub off on somebody else. Your goodness is to help others want to be good. Your self-control is to help others be self-controlled. And so wrong desires are easy to ignite. Man, I told you, it takes that long for a man to sin lustfully. Yet, the spirit of the fruit, it's difficult to ignite. Let me tell you what I'm talking about there. It takes intentional effort to be filled with the Spirit of God. You do not wake up any morning and go, "Ooh, I'm filled with the Spirit of God today." That's not how you wake up. When you wake up, you are always filled with your flesh. Oh, is it another day? My eyelids are heavy. How many hours of work do I have to do today? Now, some of you are just to the point where you're just glad to wake up. You're thinking, "Thank you, Lord, I got another day." But it's difficult to ignite the fruit of the Spirit. So, what do I mean by intentionality? It takes intention to say thank you to the Lord in prayer. It takes intention to say to someone else, "You mean a lot to me. Thank you so much for that word of encouragement." You have to plan ahead. You have to plan ahead. When we were recognizing all of those this morning who serve in our music, I didn't just plan that this morning. I wasn't writing cards this morning. I've been planning that. And I had to go get the flowers. And I had to go buy things. And I wanted it to be something that they would appreciate. But I had to spend time doing that. Because I'm thinking about somebody besides me. You understand? It is difficult to ignite the fruit of the Spirit. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all things. It takes intentionality to pray. I love being back in this habit of every night before I go to bed, just kneeling beside my bed and saying thank you to the Lord. Try not to ask for anything. Just say thank you to him. Just say thank you, Lord. Thank you. It's intentional to be filled with the Spirit of God, to be filled with the Spirit of Jesus. You have to be intentional. It takes intentionality to read the Word of God. You won't accidentally, most of you, end up with the Bible falling on your feet open to John. You understand? It's going to take intentionality. For you to read the Word of God, you have to be intentional about it. And without the Word of God being in your life and memorizing the Word of God and reading the Word of God, you will not be filled with the Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit means you must have the Bible in your life. It's so important. The Bible must be in your life. You've got to read it. You've got to study it. You've got to live with it. I mean, in every way, you try to line up with the Word of God. So it's difficult to ignite the fruit of the Spirit. Our wrong desires are always self-centered. Guys, have you ever walked out of the room after saying something to your wife and said, "Why did I say that?" Nobody else, some guy better fess up. Dwayne, I know you better than that. Okay. I'm not the only one. You've got to, you think, why did I say that? See, it's easy for any of us at any time to be self-centered. But the fruit of the Spirit is always giving, self-giving. Now move to the next one. Our wrongful desires are oppressive and possessive. That's the fleshly nature. There's a wonderful country song about this. In fact, there's probably many of them. But the one that deserves the award, which is on a number of your playlists, is this. I want to talk about me. I want to talk about my. I want to talk about number one. Y'all know the song. I mean, that if there was ever a wrong desire about oppressive, possessive, that's it. You understand? Some people are very possessive of relationships. That's my friend. That's my person. That's my deacon. You can be possessive. My pew, my parking spot. You can be possessive about anything. I mean, I've had people say, "That's my Publix." I think, well, I don't know why. There's like 18 of them on every corner, you know. That one doesn't have to be yours. Have you looked at that one? And so, I mean, you can be possessive about anything. When you become really, really possessive of people, and I have seen this with both wives with husbands and husbands with wives, you are in an unhealthy place. When a man